Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Even as the investigations into the 2G scam are now on and several high-profile figures are already in jail, a new set of allegations have emanated against current textiles minister and former telecommunications minister Dayanidhi Maran. We have with us associate editor of the Times of India, Shankar Raghuraman, and with whom we shall discuss the issue of malfeasance and a little bit more. So Shankar, a system of spoils has been generated in both these cases. Wherein ministers have manipulated the license system, favored a certain player in this in both the cases, and then also got a bit of the spoils. Now, could you just tell us a bit about the modus operandi that's common to both these cases?
Well, what is common is really the fact that unlike in the past, ministers now have control over national resources which can be privatized, right? That was not possible in an earlier era, right, where these were regarded as public sector monopolies. Right. So that's now become possible. Right. That creates a whole new arena, right, where spoils are available, where they wouldn't have been available earlier. So that's the common pattern. Right. And it's, to be fair, it's not just the DMK which is playing this game, right, but the DMK has some advantages which others haven't had. Right.
Now, the DMK has made the most hay out of the sunshine, in the sense that it has been in power far more than any other political party in the country in the last 15 years at least. That's why the DMK is central in this, in this whole issue of malfeasance.
You mentioned the period of the last 15 years. Yes. That is starting 1996, yes, when the DMK joined the United Front government in New Delhi. From that period on, there's roughly a year when they were not in power at the center, which was when Jayalalitha was part of the first NDA government. Yes. Apart from that, they have always had ministers in the central government since 1996. Yes. Now, one thing which has aided this process is the somewhat peculiar politics of Tamil Nadu, where either of the Dravidian parties tends to sweep the parliamentary elections, and typically the one which has the Congress as the ally will be the one that sweeps in a parliamentary election, not necessarily in an assembly election, as we just saw. Now, that also means that if the alliance sweeps, then whether it's the DMK or the ADMK, the winning Dravidian party has a huge chunk of seats in the Lok Sabha. Yes. And typically they end up as being either the largest or among the largest allies of either the Congress or the BJP, or even in a united front kind of situation. So right now, for instance, the DMK is the second largest ally after the Trinamool Congress. DMK is very specific on the kind of portfolios it wants. Telecom is one portfolio which it has been insisting on for quite some time now. It has in the past held portfolios like environment, shipping. These are portfolios which are, if you notice, the common thread is they're all so-called economic ministries, yes, right? Yes. And in many of these cases, in the environment, for instance, yes, the ability to block or allow clearances, yes, means that there is a possibility of rents being garnered. Right. Similarly, in telecom, because you have licenses and spectrum to give away, there again the possibility of rents being garnered is very high. Right. So it is interesting that they have focused on these kinds of portfolios. There's also an advantage that a regional party has vis-a-vis a national party in terms of corruption. The advantage being that you have to contest elections only in one state, right? And if you can build a system of patronage and therefore distribute a large amount of goodies and freebies, then what image you carry nationally becomes of no consequence. Okay. Right. Right. This is not true of a party like the Congress or the BJP, right, where the BJP nationally will suffer some damage from the image that, say, Yediyurappa has. Or the Congress suffers when Chavan has to be dismissed because of a corruption scandal. That doesn't apply to a party like the DMK. Right. So they've made the most of the circumstances which exist and develop this system of patronage.
Can it also be said that rentierism, which you are talking about, and also the patronage system, is something that has afflicted Indian polity as a whole. In the sense that, as Ashok Mitra points out in his Telegraph article, that any political party these days, irrespective of ideology, excepting for the left, is primarily a party of spoils. But what the DMK shows is a certain degree of, you know, perversion of this patronage model, and also some kind of a democratization of this patronage or rentierism model, which was limited to the Congress or the larger national parties, but it's now being done in a even larger scale, relative to the size of the political party, but followed by this, followed by regional parties such as DMK as well, right?
It is true that there is a whole new arena of spoils which did not exist earlier. See, that's the result of the liberalization of the economy, right? Where earlier entire areas were operated only by the public sector, the private sector now has entered into those areas. And typically, they are areas in which there are key natural resources to be given away to somebody. You know, whether it's mining, whether it's telecom, whether it's power, etc. So, contrary to the theory that the liberalizers pushed, which was that as government gets out of business and there are less and less discretionary controls available with the government and licensing goes out of the window, the scale of corruption will come down. It is now quite 20 years down the line. It is now very, very evident that exactly the opposite has happened. The scale of corruption has gone up to levels which would have been undreamt of two decades ago. And yes, I mean, for the DMK, it has worked particularly well. They've also discovered, I think, in the process of liberalization, one thing which happened was the DMK had always had a very good understanding of the use of media. And I'm using media here in the larger sense, including things like films and so on, all forms of media. The DMK as a party, the Dravidian movement as a movement, had a very good understanding of the use of these fora. But post-liberalization, they also discovered that media could be used not just for propaganda, but could also be a great money spinner. So the whole process of Sun TV and the control over the cable distribution network and so on, it gave them a new understanding of the extent to which, you know, controlling resources can lead to money spinning.
For the DMK, though, it started off as a symbol of regionalization and a party that drew its ideology from the social movement led by E.V. Ramaswamy or Tandai Periyar. But now it seems to be like any other patronage dispensing political outfit. Could you just tell a bit about this transformation?
There is a process of de-ideologization of the DMK. Not just of the DMK, it's a more pervasive phenomenon. But it is particularly telling in the case of the DMK, you know, which today has even stopped paying lip service to the ideology of Periyar or of Anna. You know, there is no longer talk about, you know, the Dravidian movement in any meaningful sense. There is certainly no furthering of the agenda of, you know, anti-Brahminism. Even in its early years, it had corrupted anti-Brahminism to anti-Brahmin.
Yes.
You know, so a state like Tamil Nadu, which has one of the oldest histories of a movement against the Brahminical order, it is ironical that today it is probably the state with the worst record of atrocities against Dalits, for instance, right? And neither of the Dravidian parties has really done anything about that. So all of that, I mean, you mentioned Dr. Ashok Mitra. When a party becomes bereft of ideology, then what is it that keeps people together? I mean, why does it exist as a party? Obviously, the uniting thing then can be only two things. One is power and the other is money. And both of these are, you know, you need power to get money and you need money to get power.
Let's talk specifically on this means of making money. You know, in the pre-liberalization era, corruption was done in a different way, in the sense that the ministers used to basically get bribes or cuts in while deciding contracts. But now corruption is of a different, far higher scale. Now ministers demand stakes in the new businesses, and as you pointed out, the media empire that the DMK's minions have created, the Marans, for example, has now branched out into other sectors of the economy as well, aviation, so on and so forth. And in this Dayanidhi Maran case, at least in the allegations, it's very clear that the interests of the Sun Group and that of the DMK are intertwined in this.
Absolutely. One, as I said, the sheer scale of what is achievable is much larger today. Right. I mean, for example, in the 2G spectrum scam, the CAG's estimate of the loss to the exchequer is 1.76 lakh crore.
Right.
Now, what corruption could a person pre-91 have indulged in, which could have yielded anything, even a fraction of that total? Right. So, the scale has changed. B, you were talking about how politicians have themselves started running businesses and so on. That again, I mean, pre-liberalization, it was the attempt of every politician to try and portray himself as having no connections, because connections, immediately the word used would be nexus. So everybody wanted to portray himself as having no nexus with business. Post-liberalization, that value system has changed totally. Right? It is no longer a bad thing to be seen as having links with business. You, in fact, have businessmen becoming politicians. You have, for example, Anil Ambani becoming a Rajya Sabha MP. Right? You've had others like Viren Shah of the BJP and so on. You can keep Vijay Mallya. There's a whole host of names of prominent businessmen who have joined politics, become MPs and so on. So it's no longer a no-no. Now, once that has happened, then what is to prevent the politician from himself? Also, the scale of the corruption means that you are able to actually own a business empire, which was not possible earlier again, right? And once you have the ability to own a business empire, and there is no price to be paid for that in terms of public perception, then what is to prevent it from happening? So that's exactly what's happened. And of course, then it complicates matters further, because once you are in business yourself, then apart from just, rent seeking, you also become a player in the whole corporate business. You're yourself a corporate player. So even the presumed non-partisanship of the minister goes for a six.
So in essence, some degree of legislation which, at least addresses this office of profit should be present, that should actually regulate ministers from doing what they are currently doing, right?
See, Srini, I don't think any legislation can deal with this, because it's a question of the fundamental underpinnings of this system, right? What can the piece of legislation do? Can you today, given today's ideological moorings of the system, can you have a piece of legislation which says that businessmen cannot be MPs, or that MPs cannot be businessmen? It would run completely contrary to the very ethos of liberalization, right? So I don't think laws can deal with this. The only thing that can deal with it is a political mobilization against this whole system of crony capitalism. And unfortunately, the left certainly has pointed out these factors, but I don't think there is a sufficiently strong mobilization as of now against this whole phenomenon of crony capitalism, pointing out what liberalization has led to. It has not quite gathered the kind of momentum one would have expected to gather.